Okay. So try to understand that modulation is a process that causes shift in the range of frequencies of a signal. Okay. Let me write the definition here. So your modulation is a process that causes, good. So modulation is a process that causes shift in the range of frequencies of a signal. Okay, so let's say we have a signal like this. Okay, I am showing you the frequency domain of a signal. Okay, and let's say this is your omega m and this is your minus omega m. Okay, so that means this is a signal that occupies a bandwidth of omega m. Okay, whenever I draw a signal like this, this means this is a signal, obviously, in the frequency domain. Try to understand that it is in the frequency domain. Okay, so if I try to visualize this signal in the time domain, no? So it will look like this. It may be something like this. Okay, some signals will be mixed here. There might be some signals like this. So this is in the time domain. Try to understand this. Time domain. Okay, so see the definition of modulation. Modulation is a process that causes shift in the range of frequencies of a signal. So you could see that si this signal occupies a bandwidth of omega m. It starts at zero, it starts from zero frequency and it ends at omega m frequency. That means it has all the intermediate frequency. There may be 1 radian per second. There might be 2 radian, 3 radian, 4 radians, dot 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 dot, up to omega m radians per second. This signal has. Now, once we modulate this signal, try to understand this. Once we modulate this signal, what will happen? See, this is your zero position. Okay, so this signal will be shifted somewhere here. Okay, this shift signal will be shifted somewhere here, and this frequency here is your omega c. Okay, omega c is nothing but a carrier frequency. The carrier is actually responsible for taking this signal from, you could see this signal was starting from zero, huh? Zero, and now it is starting from omega c. You could see omega c. So that means the center frequency, so it has actually shifted the signal to omega c. So the range of frequencies that were present, those frequencies will still be present. However, they are shifted to some other band. So modulation is a process by which we are shifting this range of frequencies. Got it? Now the question is why we are doing this, and how we are doing this. So normally we use a signal which is called your carrier to shift this. Okay. So if you could recall the previous property of Fourier transform, the frequency shifting property. Now, we are just using that property to shift the signal. If you have a signal x of t after Fourier transform, it is capital X of omega, then e to the power j omega ct. Let's say in place of omega 0, I am taking omega ct multiplied with x of t, okay, is actually your capital X of omega minus omega 0. So this is the property that we use to shift the signal and these frequencies. So what we are essentially doing is, see, this is the signal x of t. Try to understand that this is the signal x of t. And along with this signal, we are multiplying another signal, which is your e to the power j omega ct. So once we multiply this signal, e to the power j omega ct, that I have highlighted in green. So if you multiply it, it will be shifted towards this. Okay. So that is the effect here. Okay. So e to the power j omega ct you are multiplying. So practically what happens, it is really difficult to generate that e to the power j omega ct. So what we could instead do is we could multiply a cosine waveform, cosine or sine waveform. So because a cosine waveform will be a combination of both of these waveforms, e to the power j omega ct plus e to the power minus j omega ct by 2, okay, which is also equal to e to the power j omega ct, and a half let it be outside. It was j omega ct, okay, or half plus half, it was j, it was minus j omega ct. So you are getting here this J omega city. So there will be obviously this kind of shift in the frequency domain. So a low frequency signal here is actually translated to higher frequency. That is the process of modulation. Okay? And this cosinusoidal signal that you saw here, that we multiplied with the signal, that is called a carrier. Try to understand. This is called your carrier. And the communication that uses this kind of carrier is called your carrier communication. Okay? So let me write it here. That communication that uses modulation. Obviously, in modulation, we are using carrier. Okay? Is called your carrier communication. You could note it. This is very important. Carrier communication. Got it? So this process is quite similar to, let me just give you an example, a real life example, and you will understand what is the significance of this carrier, how it is significant. Let's say you have finished your 4 years of engineering, okay? And you are going back home, and within these 4 years, you have accumulated a lot of baggage. You want to take it back. Okay, you have within these 4 years, maybe let's say you have purchased a computer, a desktop, you have purchased. Besides that, you have purchased a bicycle, a bike, or something. That a lot of things are there. Your baggage is actually, let's say, cannot be carried just by a simple car. You need a, let's say, a truck to transport it. You cannot carry it back to your home. So what you will normally do, the first thing that you will do is you will pack your luggage. Once you have packed your luggage, a truck will actually carry it. Okay, a truck will actually carry it to your home. Okay, so this package that you packed here is your message. Okay, is your message. In the terms of communication, this will be called the message, and this truck that carried it is your carrier. Okay. So without your carrier, it is really impossible to send the messages over a longer distance. Okay. So without modulation, you cannot carry it over a longer distance. You need a carrier for that. Okay. So this way it will reach your home. Okay, it will reach the destination. Did you got it? So this is how the carrier works. Okay. So now we will understand the need of modulation. Like, why we need this modulation? What is the requirement? Okay, can't we do away without modulation? That we have to understand. Okay. So for that, there is this need of modulation. So there are multiple reasons for which we require modulation. One by one, I will explain you why we need modulation. So number one is obviously for transmitting the signal over a longer distance. Okay, so without modulation, let's say you want to transmit your voice over a longer distance. Okay, you want to transmit your voice over a longer distance. So how will you transmit? What is the process? Obviously, the one way you could use to transmit your signal over a longer distance is you could amplify it. Okay, let's say this is your voice. Okay, and you used an amplifier, and using this amplifier, you increase the strength. Then you used a loudspeaker, the ones that they used, mics. I think you must have seen this kind of diaphragm that they use. So using this, you will transmit. So if you transmit it, obviously based on the weather and the noise conditions, it will reach over a longer distance, maybe a few kilometers. Okay, maybe a few kilometers. But what if you want to transmit it over much longer distance? Okay, will this mic work? What do you think? If I let's say amplify this signal to the highest power possible. Let me use a nuclear power plant to power this amplifier, and
telecast your voice. Will it reach the other end of the world?
No, sir.
So that is the problem. Even if you use a nuclear power plant to power your amplifier, okay, your voice will reach over a few kilometers. And within its reach of this few kilometers, it will create serious noise for the other people. Okay, but because at the source, obviously, you will be generating it at the highest possible strength. Okay. So that's why, so that is the first reason for which we require modulation for transmitting the signal over a longer distance. So, in place of this, if you take a signal and you modulate it, okay, you modulate it by using a high frequency carrier, okay, high frequency carrier like this, then obviously it will be converted into a high frequency signal and it could be transmitted over a longer distance without the need of this mic that you used. Okay, a simple transmitting antenna will do the job. A simple transmitting antenna will do the job. Okay, so this was the first reason for using modulation. I hope you have understood it. Then the second one is the multiplexing of signals. Multiplexing of signal. Okay. So, multiplexing is the process of transmitting more than one signal through the same channel. Our voice frequency is, let's say, around 20 hertz. Let's say it is 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. Okay. So, if you represent this in the frequency domain, it will be like this. Okay, let's say this is 20 kilohertz. Okay, so this is minus 20 kilohertz. Let's say it is like this. So now what happens? Okay, let's say you are transmitting your voice. So this is your voice. Okay, there is somebody else who is also transmitting at the same time. Okay, then his or her voice will be like this. It will be on top of this. Okay, then let's say somebody else is again transmitting. His or her voice will be on top of this. So what will happen? These signals will mixed up with each other and they will be actually creating noise there. Okay. For you, the other two signals might be the noise. For them, your signal might be the noise. Okay. So this kind of problem will exist. Now, if you use modulation, modulation means we will be multiplying that e to the power j omega ct, right? We will be multiplying that e to the power j omega ct in the time domain. So when you multiply this e to the j omega ct, why don't you choose different values of omega c? So if I choose values of omega c as omega c1, okay, e to the power j omega c2, then e to the power j omega c3t in this way. So what will happen, when I multiply omega c1, this signal will be shifted like this. Let me show you. So this is your omega C1. This is your omega C2. And this is your omega C3. Now, what is the benefit here? The benefit is, see, the green signal is this one. The blue signal is this one. Okay. And then the red signal is this one. That I had represented. So these are the signals of the three users. And if you transmit them at the same time through the same channel, they will not get mixed because they are separated in frequency. How we were able to separate them in frequency? By choosing, you could see, by choosing different value of omega C1. So if omega C. So if you choose different values of omega C, you could see that they are actually occupying different locations in the frequency domain, and due to that, they do not get mixed up with each other. Okay, so this is also the reason why we modulate signals so that we could transmit more than one signal through the same channel. Okay, otherwise, only one person will be utilizing the channel at once. Okay, if you do not use multiplexing. I hope you have understood it, right? The number three is reduction in antenna height. okay, lambda is equal to C by F. Okay, so there is one more thing there, that is there is as a problem. Let's say multiplexing is not a problem. Let's say multiplexing is not a problem, and you could generate your you could have your own channel and you could transmit, and let's say power is not a issue for you. Okay, let's say. However, the other problem that we will have while transmitting a signal is basically the size of the antenna. Okay, so normally the height of an antenna is actually directly you could see, huh, that it will be somewhat proportional to the wavelength. Normally the dimensions of the antenna are somewhat professional, like proportional to the wavelength. Wavelength here is, as you could see, is a lambda here. There could be antennas like the half wave dipole, half, then quarter wave monopole. So normally they will be lambda by 2 times, lambda by 4 times, like that. Or some dimension might be lambda also. Okay. So let's say you have a signal of 1 kilohertz. Okay. And you are designing an antenna. Okay. So the height of the antenna is actually h is equal to around c by f. So we have assumed that the dimension is h here, and it is equal to c by f. So c is your speed of light, okay, and f is basically the frequency, okay, frequency of the signal that you want to transmit. Now let's say I have a 1 kilohertz signal. Could you just calculate the height of the antenna that is possible for a 1 kilohertz signal? Just try it. Use the formula. You know the speed of the light.
3 into 10 to power 5, 30,000 meter.
Tell me, could you just again tell me? Yeah. 3 into 10 to the power 5. This much you are getting?
Yes, sir.
Meter per second. Sorry, not meter per second, it will be meters. Yeah, right. Okay. So, can you make an antenna of this height? Can you make an antenna? Let me just show you. Let us just divide it by 10 to the power 3. If we divide it by 10 to the power 3, I think we will be able to convert it into kilometer, right? So it will be, I think, 300
kilometers, sir.
Kilometer. Okay. So can you construct an antenna of height 300? Do you think it is practical enough to design an antenna of 300 kilometers? Can anybody do that?
No, sir.
No, sir.
That is the difficulty when you are using a signal of 1 kilohertz. But you could see that the signals that we are generating are actually really low frequency signals. 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz is quite low. Even for 20 kilohertz, which we normally do not generate, we generate around 10 kilohertz. Our frequency is around 10 kilohertz. So if you're generating 10 kilohertz, okay, then you could easily assume the kind of antenna you will be requiring. Only one zero will be reduced from this 300 kilometer. You will be still left with 30 kilometer. So it is quite impossible to design an antenna of that height. Okay. So in place of this, what you could do is you could choose a higher frequency. Let's say the height of the frequency of a radio station is 92.7 megahertz. You must have listened to it, huh? Big FM, 92.7. megahertz is the frequency. So now can you calculate what will be the height of antenna for this signal? So 92.7 into 10 to the power 6 hertz is the frequency. Now could you find out the height of the antenna?
Yes, sir. Sir, point, sir, it is correct, sir. 0.032 into 10 to power 1.
So we could we write it like this? 3.2 meter?
Yes, sir.
So now you could find out what is the minimum height of the antenna you are requiring. Okay. How drastically it reduced. This is the dimension of the antenna that you will require. So this happens only if we increase the frequency of the signal. So this is also one of the reasons for which we require the process of modulation. Okay. Then number 4 is your narrow banding of signals. Okay, So narrow banding we have to understand in this way. So let's take a signal, let's say the range of frequencies that we use to communicate, it is around your 50 to your 10 to the power 4 hertz. Okay, this is the range of frequencies. Now, mostly the range of audio frequency that we use. Okay. Audio frequencies. So now let's say that the height of the antenna is not a big issue for us. We are using some balloons to have our antenna there in the at 300 kilometer. Let's say, or we have some collaboration with NASA and we are sending our antennas on that they are located on the top of some sun synchronous satellite. Now you could see there will be another problem. What is that another problem? You see, the range of frequencies that we have, you know, our audio frequencies that we use is from 50 hertz to 10 to the 4 hertz. Now just try to find out the height of the antenna for 50 hertz signal and then 10 to the power 4 hertz signal. Could you just find it? You will find there is a quite interesting fact you will actually excavate once you find it out.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now just look at these facts here, that the voice signal that you are generating is the audio signal, that we are generating is from 50 to 10 to the power 4 hertz. This is our audible range of frequency. Now could you see that we need an antenna, okay, for transmitting that signal of 50 hertz? You could see that the height of the antenna is 6000 kilometer, and then for transmitting this signal of 10 to the 4 hertz, we need an antenna of 30 kilometer. So we need an antenna, okay, when you will be transmitting your voice or your audio signal, then we will be needing an antenna which will expand to 6000 kilometer and contract to 30 kilometer. Okay, so is that possible? I don't think so. It will be quite complicated. Okay, so now do one thing, and let us do a small more important exercise. So you have the 92.7 megahertz, 92.7 into 10 to the 6. Okay, this is the frequency of that channel. So along with it, okay, you just add once 50 hertz and say to this only 92.7 into 10 to the 6, okay, plus your 10 to the power 4 hertz. You add it and then you find out the height of the antenna. You will find that the difference will be really slight. You could find it out. Just find it, then we will discuss. For 92.7 into 10 to the 6 plus 50. Okay. So this much frequency, what is the height of the antenna that you are requiring? Because once you are modulating this signal of 50 hertz, okay, so it will be transmitted using this carrier of 92.7 megahertz. Okay. Similarly, 10 to the 4 hertz signal will be again transmitted using a carrier of 92.7 into 10 to the 6 hertz. So can you just find out what will be the height of antenna for these two signals? Any answers?
Sir, they're almost equal, 3.23 meter.
Yes, 3.23 meter. The other one is also around 3.23 meter, right?
Yes.
So you could see, you could see the difference. When we were directly trying to transmit this signal, we needed an antenna which will expand to 6000 kilometer and which will contract to 30 kilometer for sending these frequencies. Okay. Whereas when we modulated this signal, we required the same antenna to transmit. Okay. We required the same antenna to transmit both these signals. Okay. So this is the reason, also one of the reasons for which we are using modulation. Okay, so this is also one of the reasons for which we require modulations. So by modulation, what we are able to do is we are actually able to convert a wide band signal into a, you could say, a narrow band signal. This process is actually called your narrow banding. Okay, so next is your common processing. This is the fifth point, fifth reason, common processing of signal is also a reason. So try to understand another problem. There will be another problem then where you are using a signal of, let's say, your 10 to the power 1. Yes. So if you are taking a signal of, let's say, 50 hertz, and then you are taking a signal of 10 to the 4 hertz, then there will be another problem. You must have all read about amplifiers, right? Amplifiers. So once you have received the signal, that has passed through the medium, obviously the strength of that signal, if you have transmitted a signal like this, then the strength of the signal will be would have been reduced. It would have been like this. Okay. Although the frequency might be same, but there might be some small shift in the frequency also. However, we are concerned mainly with the amplitude of the signal. So amplitude of the signal might have reduced. So you will use a device. This was the effect of the channel. So you will use a device to amplify this signal. Okay. So by using an amplifier, you could do this. Now, if you could recall, there was a chapter you might have read, the frequency response of BJT and FET amplifier. Have you read it in analog electronics? So there you would find that amplifiers are actually designed to operate at a particular range of frequencies that we show like this. If this is F1, this is F2, so the amplifier will successfully operate within this band of frequencies. Okay. Let's say this is F1 and this is F2, not this one. So this is the range of frequencies within that the amplifier will behave properly. Okay. How this is actually decided, you know, if I show you, let me just show you an amplifier. If this is a amplifier, okay. So you would see that the circuit looks something like this. We use some capacitor here. We use a resistor here. We use some capacitor here. This is the ground here. And then this is the VCC here. And then we apply the input signal at these terminals. And then we get the output here. Okay. Here we apply the input and here we get the output. So in this amplifier, you could see there are some typical components. These. Okay, in order to make this transistor operate, okay, you need these resistors. And then there are these capacitors. The job of these capacitors are multiple, actually. Sometimes they are used to block the DC. Sometimes they are used for some other purposes. However, the presence of these resistors and capacitors makes it a filter. Okay, a filter which is actually capable of taking particular signals, okay, and passing particular signals and blocking particular signals. So every amplifier has its own frequency response. Try to understand this. All amplifiers will have their own frequency response over which they will be flat, or they will operate, or they will behave properly. They will amplify the signal within this range of frequency. Now, the signals that we will be receiving, okay, by your, which would have passed through the channel, they will be of different frequencies. Okay. So, at that time, it becomes really difficult for one amplifier, okay, to behave properly at all the frequencies or amplify signals at all different frequencies. Let's say one signal you have at 20 kilohertz, one signal you have at 40 kilohertz, one signal you have at 80 kilohertz, and the amplifier is designed to operate only at 40 kilohertz. So it will not be able to provide the perfect level of amplification to the signals which are at 20 kilohertz and 80 kilohertz. So that is a problem with normal amplifiers or the normal circuits that you use for processing the signal. So in that case, modulation becomes really important. So in modulation, what we do, once we have transmitted the signal by using some modulation, let's say this is our signal, and using a carrier signal, we have modulated it and we have transmitted it. Okay. So once you have transmitted this signal, once it is received by a receiver, okay, the receiver actually recreates the signal. So at the receiver, what we could do is we could convert this signal into a frequency which is called your intermediate frequency or IF. Intermediate frequency. Okay, IF. And this intermediate frequency is actually fixed for all the different signals. Whatever be the input signal frequency, it may be your 92.7, it may be your 93.5 megahertz, or it may be any other frequency, okay? The intermediate frequency is always the same. We try to multiply a signal in such a way with this incoming signal that the intermediate frequency that we generate is always same. Always same, and it is always fixed for a receiver. Okay, it is always fixed for a receiver. So once it is always same and it is always fixed, you could use the same amplifier for all the signals. You could use the same amplifier for all the signals. Okay, so this will be possible only if you have modulated the signal. Otherwise, without modulation, it will be quite difficult. So this is also one of the reasons for which we require modulation. Okay. Then besides this, another reason is obviously your security. If you take a mic and you would shout from your roof, everybody will listen to you. Whatever information you are transmitting is actually listened by everyone. However, if you modulate it, obviously it will become a little bit secure. And if you are using digital modulation and along with it you are using encryption, it is impossible for anyone to decode your signal. So this is also one of the reasons. And then another reason might be your noise immunity. Modulation provides some degree of noise immunity. So if you are using digital modulation, obviously it will be more immune to noise. Okay. If you are using digital modulation, it will be highly immune to noise, because the receiver has to make only a guess between 1 or 0. So it becomes more immune to noise. So these are the reasons for which we require modulation.